So today will be the second part of the introduction. And after we finish the introductory part for what is cognition, we will start from next week talking about different cognitive fields. So just we'll start with a short reminder. So we talked last time about the cognitive revolution, how to study behavior. The dominant approach until the 50s was a behaviorist view, meaning pairing input and output, and whatever goes into the mind or the brain, we only need to know know what the output is and pair between them, because the brain is like a black box. We don't have any access to it. And then after the cognitive revolution, the focus changed not to pairing input and output, but to understanding what the functions or transformations on the input happen within the black box. So now the focus is what happens in the black box and not just the input. Not just the behavior. So the assumption in cognitive science is that we have mental states, which are representations of the outside world, and these mental states undergo transformation, which is information processing, in a way. So we add to the input in the process of transforming the input into whatever is needed. So these are the assumptions, and we saw different ways to describe what happens within the black box. So we talked about different kinds of models. One model, which is the cognitive model, or modular model, or the boxes and arrows model. This is an example of the memory model. And we saw other kinds of models, connectionist models, which describe what happens in the black box in terms of connections between nodes. So we talked about a symbolic network in which each node represents some concept or a mental state, if you want, and a distributed network in which it is not each node separately that represents a concept, but the whole network together. So I was asked about it last time, so I'll just stress it out again. In this kind of network, in order to represent a dog, all you need is this node. So even if we take off all the other nodes, we still have a way to represent the dog. In this network, if we want to represent a dog or a cat or whatever concept, we need the whole network, because think about it as a vector representation. We need each and every element, because the whole pattern of activation is important. We started last time to look at a specific example of a cognitive phenomenon, the Stroop effect, and we started last time to see different models that describe the effect, so let's just remind ourselves the Stroop effect. Anyone wants to remind all of us what the Stroop effect is? Or the Stroop task? Let's start with the task.
The color task, right?
Okay, right, so color and...
That one part is reading the word and the other part is reading, looking at the color.
Yeah. Right.
Focusing on both.
Yeah. So we focused on only one task, when you need to name the color and not read the word. And then we saw that there is an interference of the content of the word. So this is called a semantic interference. And this is the first reaction time experiment. So we're going to see many reaction time experiments, and we're going to talk in a little bit about why we use reaction time. So reaction time for incongruent words is slower compared to neutral words. So incongruent is, for instance, red written in green. You have to say green, but the word red interferes. Semantic facilitation, if it is congruent, if red is written in red, it will be easier for you to say red compared to when chair is, let's say, written in red. And there is an asymmetry. If the task is to read the word, we see a much weaker Stroop effect. It still exists, but it's much weaker. Last time, I also said something about the design table, and then I'll say, okay, let's look at it next time and draw the whole design table. But basically, when we start with an experiment, we want to know what our factors are and what are levels within each factor. So the things that interest us when we run an experiment, the things that we manipulate, are called factors. So this is one factor, which is the congruency. So when we started, the first example of the Stroop task that I showed you, there was only one factor which we manipulated, whether it's congruent or non-congruent. So this is called a 1x2 design, because if we put it down in a table, we see that the task naming a color has only one level, right? There's only one task. They didn't tell you yet that there was another task. And in the congruency, we have two levels, and these are the items. So a congruent item or stimulus is red written in red, for instance, and an incongruent is red written in green. Now then, I told you we have a baseline, a neutral level, which is also part of the congruency factor. So this is a design table of the Fuller experiment, which is now 3x1 design, not a 2x1, because we have three levels in the factor of congruency. And as Mark said, there is also the other half of this experiment is when the task is reading the word and not naming the color. And now this is the complete design table of the Stroop task. So we say that the Stroop experiment is a 3x2 experiment. Okay, it has two factors, one factor of congruency with three levels, and one factor of the task with two levels. And these are examples of the items in the Stroop task. Now, how do we explain? Okay, we have a finding of semantic interference and semantic facilitation. How do we explain it? So we started to look at different models which have maybe different predictions. So let's finish this part. So first we saw this model, which says we have an input, and this input is separated into two paths of information processing. One path processes the color, and the other path processes the content. And then these two paths go together to the output, which is the response. Now, how would this model explain the effect, the Stroop effect, right? We see that the content, right, if we see red, the word red written in green, the content interferes. So what would be one way to explain why the output sees this information or gives priority to this information? Think about a very simple explanation. Okay, there is information flow, it goes here, and then the output prioritizes this. One reason would be what? What? Yeah, okay, so speed. So just faster, okay? This just arrives faster to the output, and before the color information arrives, the content information is already there. What's another option, or what did it say? So speed is one explanation. Another explanation, which we'll talk more about when we talk about attention, is that processing verbal information is automatic as opposed to processing color information. So an automatic process requires no time, and it's mandatory, and you can't avoid it. This is very broadly what an automatic process is. Basically, it requires no attention. And we'll talk more about it in the attention class. A second model that we saw is a neural network model. This is a feed-forward model because we have all these nodes are in the input layer. Then we have an intermediate layer and then an output layer. And if we try to explain the Stroop effect, so let's go together over this network and see what's going on. So first of all, we see that in the input, we have not only the color and the content, we have another, let's say, two nodes that contribute to another kind of input, which is what is the task demand, which we didn't have in the previous model. Now, is this a symbolic network? Why not?
Yes. Yes. Each node represents one function.
Okay, right, because this node is red. It's not a vectorized representation. Shlomi asked me last time, why can it be both, right? That's what he asked me. So, yeah, of course we can complicate it. It can be both. It can be that here we have many different nodes. But to simplify things, right now this is a symbol. Yeah.
If you want to represent the Stroop effect, you need all the nodes. So,
that they need all the nodes?
Yeah.
Let's put all the nodes in one layer. Let's say that the color is represented not by one node and another node, but let's say by a vector. So it's not. We can play with like intermediate networks, something between a distributed and a symbolic, but this is 100% symbolic. Each node represents a concept. Now let's say we see red colored in green. So what would be the input? Let's look only at the input layer. So which nodes are activated? So the ink color would be
green,
because it's red colored in green, so the color is green. The task demand the tag to access classical truth is the color naming, so this will be activated, this won't be, and the word would be red. Now, in a connectionist network, what the important thing is the connection between the nodes. Okay? They make everything happen. So if here we have a positive activation, sorry, the color green, we have a positive activation, it means that if green is activated, it also activates this node, but it inhibits this node. Okay? So we have an activation here. We don't have an activation here. So now let's try to compute what's going on. So the color naming activates these two nodes in the color hidden unit or intermediate layer, and the red input activates this input. So what is the function of the intermediate layer?
It's the processing.
Okay, what kind of processing?
All your inputs, you have two different inputs in your processing, the output. It's just the processing. What I don't understand here is, imagine red is activating the node in the word name hidden units, but your color naming is inhibiting that one. And
exactly.
That one is why, because you have the delay. You have the delay because when there's one node activated, that's
oh,
that
okay.
Node.
So let's go over the whole thing and maybe,
okay.
Maybe I'm rephrasing what you said because I didn't really understand the delay part. If these two are activated, and this is inhibited, the green inhibits, they think that this is the task demand, these are activated, these are not. But out of these two activations, this is inhibited. So we have here the this node activated, which activates green, which is
the
incorrect response, right? So what happens in the intermediate layer is the interaction between the task demand and the input. So this is what this network does. Okay, it computes the input according to the task demand. Now, of course, you won't say green. There is also you will know that it is red because this is also activated. But the strength, okay, the strength of the connection between the nodes will make this weaker than this. So that's why we see this interference. So this is another model that explains this. It doesn't necessarily explain this in terms of automatic response, but in terms of the connection between the nodes. And we can say that maybe an automatic response is a stronger node, we may not, but this is a different model to explain it. So this is just finishing from last time. Back to class, I also wanted to show an example of a distributed network that can also explain this group effect. So this is model number 3. So let's say that we have a vector, a pattern of activation of many nodes. Right now they're interconnected. They're not interconnected, each one is connected to one, it doesn't really matter. It's just in a vectorized view. And let's say, for sake of simplicity, that the first 4 nodes represent a color, and the next 4 nodes represent the content, the word. So a stable activation of red would be first 4 nodes of color, okay, and then 4 nodes of the content. So this would be a stable activation. Now, if we see an incongruent input, the word red written in green, what would be the representation? Would be something in between these two stable states. So the color would be the green representation, but the word would be the color representation. Now this is an instable state. And when you take neural networks, we'll talk about stable and instable states of activation. And now this pattern of activation has to converge to some stable state. And the convergence is towards the stable activation of red. And we can build a network with connections in such a way that it will be easier for the network in terms of, I energy levels to converge to the cycle plate. So this is another explanation of the Stroop effect, and notice that here this is a distributed network. There is no real meaning for each node separately. We're looking at the whole pattern of activation. So what do we learn from these models? Okay, these are nice ways to represent the same phenomenon, but now what do we learn from these models? And more basically, what do we learn from the Stroop effect? So one option is we have a very basic, very simple conclusion. We have a priority of reading over color. It's a very broad statement. Can we generalize from this conclusion to maybe other modalities or other tasks? This is a very specific conclusion, so it's better to try to find a more general conclusion. Okay, to say that this effect is just an example of something that our cognitive system does more in general. For instance, automatic processes. As I said, an automatic process does not require attention, and that's why it's relatively fast, it's also mandatory, and so on, as opposed to a control process. If we say that we have a very specific conclusion, not just about automatic processes, that can be not just about reading or interpreting colors, so our interpretation would be that we ignore some features of the environment, but not others, and for some maybe mysterious reason, reading is something that we just can't ignore. And it's just specific about reading. So in the field, there are many different, yeah.
So what if the words are displayed in different language? So in a language, the testees is not familiar with.
So for instance, I'm now learning Portuguese, and I just learned the color words, and I'm a subject of a Stroop effect in Portuguese, something like that. I actually don't know. That's a good question. There are many questions to be asked about the Stroop effect because this is the most, I think, investigated effect in psychology ever since the 30s. And there are many, many variations. So let's try to think what might happen. So one option would be that we have a Stroop effect, right? So what would be an explanation for that if it's a language I'm not familiar with?
It becomes supposed to be an automatic process and becomes
because you're less familiar, it's less automatic. You don't spend time processing. I mean, often very similar to a neutral system.
Okay, so this is one prediction that if it's a language which is not my native language, we will have a weaker Stroop effect. This is what Lacheva said. Because I'm less familiar with Portuguese, so it's not as automatic as English or Hebrew or whatever language you speak. So this is one option. I don't know if you tried to say the same thing or exactly the opposite.
No, it's the opposite.
Okay, the opposite.
It stops being automatic and it becomes a control process.
So you're saying actually the same thing, that there won't be a Stroop effect because it's not automatic anymore, processing the language, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, another option is that we'll see a Stroop effect just the same, and then what would be the interpretation or what hypothesis would predict this kind of finding?
It doesn't depend on language.
It doesn't depend on language, and then why do we have this effect? Maybe because, as Elisheva said, it's just faster to process words, the input, the modality, the visual modality, the linguistic modality is just faster or prioritized for some other reasons compared to colors, right? So these are two different generalizations, and I don't know the answer to this specific question. It might be that someone already tried to run this experiment because this is a very, very widely explored effect, and it's good that you asked because this is the first reading test that you're going to get. Just look for variation, there are like thousands of variation on the Stroop effect. Look in Scholar or whatever other engine you want to use. Find a variation of the Stroop test. Then just describe, first of all, in a few lines, what the variation is. If it helps, write down a design table, okay, of what the items are. according to the authors, the reason that there are so many variations is because it's still disputable why we have this effect, and different variations try to test different predictions. So your question, I forgot your name again, sorry.
Ife.
So Ife's question is exactly aimed to, or in a different way, is what is the generalization? This is what Ife asks, because if it's in another language, maybe we see different things, and then my explanation about automatic processing, maybe it's not correct. So, first of all, just a general instruction about reading tests. They're not supposed to be long, 10 lines, the most, okay? Send them to my email. This is the email for different tests and finance. And write in the email. I mean, unless you have a design table that you want to add so you can attach a Word file, but if not, just write in the email. Send me the link. I found this variation, this experiment on the Stroop. This is what they did, and that's what they conclude based on what they did. That's all. About 10 lines, no more. It's supposed to be really easy and simple. Send them to me by next week, okay? And by the way, the presentation on the Moodle is not updated, so if you forget the task, I'll upload this presentation later today. Okay, so let's go back and talk about experiments and so on. And more precisely, let's talk about modular processing. So I showed you before a modular model of the Stroop effect based on the Stroop experiment. And now let's see another example of how a modular model explains an experimental finding. So the task, okay, this is what we said last time. If we have a modular explanation, then we have different stages, and each stage or each module, there is a different processing that happens. And now let's look at the task. The task is by Michael Posner and colleagues from 1969. And it goes something like this. So the subject sees two letters, and the task is to say whether physically they are the same or different. Is this the same or the different? Or different?
Different.
Okay, why? Because this is a capital A and this is a small a. A second task, and this is similar or different? A second task would be not to compare the physical features, but to compare the semantic representation, or let's say name comparison. So if the task is name comparison, are these two similar or different? Same or different?
Same.
Okay. And these two, of course, are the same, because these two are the letter A, and of course, these two are the letter A as well. Reaction times were measured. As I said, reaction time is very central in the cognitive science. So first, before seeing the results and what Posner wanted to ask anyway, right, what is the design table of this experiment? So what are the factors? We have two factors. Okay, the kind of task, right? And this factor has how many levels? Okay, two. Whether you have to make a physical comparison or a name comparison. What would be another?
The letter.
The letter?
The symbols.
Same or different? Okay, so you're almost right in what you said. The design table will look something like this. Okay, so you are closer. I'll say in a minute why what she says is not exactly the design table. But this is a design table. We have one factor is to compare the name of the letter, and then we have two levels, whether it's similar or different. It's kind of confusing because then the Stroop, the congruency was a different factor. The other factor was compare the physical features, and then again, whether it's similar or different. And these are examples of items. So this is similar physical features and similar letter, and this is different physical features and names of letters, but similar physical features. And so on. Now, the way you presented it, maybe I even have it here. No, I don't have it here. if we had, let me write it down.
Say again, what was the design table that you said? We said that congruency or similarity is one. So we said same and different. So this would be a factor of similarity. And another factor is to compare the physical feature or the name. And this would be the test. And this is just like, so this is very similar to what we saw with this group, so it's no wonder that you immediately went to this table. Now let's try to put items in this table. What would be an item for a physical task? Same. Example.
Capital A.
What would be an example for same name? Okay, capital and non-capital, but also capital, right? So we have the same items in two different cells. And this is not how a design table is constructed. Each item has to appear in one and only one cell. The reason is we want to basically analyze, right, the contribution of each factor. And if we have the same item that belongs to two different levels in the same factor, we don't really, it's not really a manipulation. So this is just the reason that I'm insisting on thinking about the design table in each of every experiment, and I really recommend that every time that you read a paper, try to think what the design is, because it really helps to understand what we manipulate. So what we're interested in here is these two factors, and this is the manipulation within the factor. The rule is that if we're looking for interactions, which we'll talk about in a few minutes, we look at interactions between factors, not between levels. So these are the levels in this factor, these are the levels in this factor, and if we want to see if these two interact in a way, they can't be two levels in one factor. And this is the goal of this experiment. So each trial is defined on all factors. It can't be that the same stimulus or same item appears in more than one cell. So this is the design table. Now, back to the experiment. The whole design table is actually multidimensional because we have also two task requirements. And in this specific experiment, we have four different delays between the letters.
What's so on?
I'll say in a minute. So the experiment, first subject saw one letter, then there was a certain delay, and then the second letter appeared. This delay is called stimulus onset asynchrony, which is the SOA. Stimulus onset asynchrony is exactly what I said, the delay between two stimuli, between their onset times. So if I have here stimulus number one, it starts here. Stimulus number two starts here. This is the SOA. Okay? There is another term which is called the ISI, which is interstimulus interval, which is the difference between the offset of the first stimulus and the onset of the second one. So here we're talking about the SOA, which is another variable that was manipulated in this experiment. So first subject saw one letter, let's say A, and after a certain SOA, a certain delay, then they saw another one, let's say this A. So this would be the full design table. Yeah.
The goal of the, so the SOA and the ISI is to determine if it's consistent between different ranges of them.
Ranges of what?
Of ISI and SOA.
So
the specific
purpose of Posner in having an SOA is to see, to test the representation
of visual input. So, you know, let's look at the conclusions and then we'll see the
what the purpose of the SOA was.
So first of all, let's ignore the SOA. We'll add it in soon. So in the name comparison task, subjects were faster in saying that AA, two capitals, are the same compared to A and small a. Okay? In the physical comparison task, identifying that two A's, which are one is lowercase, one is uppercase, was identified in the same speed as identifying two different letters. Okay? Another finding in the physical comparison is that it was much faster to identify, let's say, BC when the physical features are very different compared to when they're closer, let's say OQ. Now here is the SOA, and we'll talk in a minute. In the end, we'll talk about why it was used for. The longer the delay was, the SOA was between the appearance of the first and the second letter, the smaller the effect was for the name comparison. So this is the name comparison. So we see that when the physical features are the same, although the task is about the name, not about the physical features, when we give subjects more time between the first and the second letter, we don't see a big difference, as I stated in the first finding. Now, the goal of Posner and his colleagues in this experiment was to test the representation. If we see something of content, whether at some point we remove the physical representation and we're left only with the name, something which is more abstract. So let's say you read something, if you want to remember something that you just read, a word, whether this representation includes how the word looks like, the script itself. And the reason to add the SOA was thinking maybe it just takes time to get to this more abstract representation. So this was the initial goal, but let's now take all these findings and try to see whether we can fit a modular model that describes these findings. So this is the model. I don't ask you what the model is. I'm just giving you the model, but let's see how it explains it. So let's start with the first finding. Name comparison. We see two uppercase letters, and we see an uppercase and a lowercase letter, the same letter. And when the physical features are the same between the two letters, it is identified faster. The reaction times are lower. How is this explained? So this is the input. We have two uppercase letters. Now let's say this arrow was not here. Okay, this is the flow of information to the response. What would be the prediction? Both letters have to go through the semantic level, to the more abstract representation, before responding. Right? Remember, this is the name task. Now, since the finding is that the physical features affect reaction time, even if the task is to name it, the conclusion is that there is an arrow between the physical module and the decision. The response. Yeah.
What do we claim, and also in the past experiments to work, that the physical level goes before the semantic level? Why can't both be the symbols can go to both at the same time and out at the same time? Or
so you're saying that you will identify the kind of letter before seeing the letter?
Not before. You see the letter,
mm-hmm.
and there's two things you recognize, the physical and the semantic. By seeing the symbol you have in front of you.
Mm-hmm.
And we claim here that first we check all the physical things about the letter and then we put a name to it.
Yeah.
But what if, and why isn't that, you just see the letter,
mm-hmm.
and yeah, you can. There's one part of the brain that checks all the physical parts, but there's another part of the brain that in the same moment it's putting the semantic piece in that shape you have in front. Why do we think that it has to go first here and then here?
It's still hard for me to understand how you can name something which is right a sort of abstraction over the physical input, like, right? Without the physical input.
It's like if you have the capital and non-capital, and you see them both at the same time. Before,
yeah.
Actually, seeing what each one is, you already know that they are different.
They're different in name.
They're different symbols.
Okay, but now the task is naming. So if you want to know that they're the same letter,
okay.
Do you need? I mean, you're saying that you don't need the physical.
I don't
the
see
physical
why
processing.
Have to go first, because it's one thing to see the symbol, the input just arrives to your eye.
Mm-hmm.
You're watching something, and then you put a physical thing. Okay, it has these angles, it has this shape.
Okay.
Then you process the physical thing, and then you process the semantic thing of the symbol you're just watching. The input is just coming, and you have an image.
Okay,
and
so
then
maybe
you process both things.
It might be that there are different depths of processing physical features. I mean, you can
okay.
read the words without starting to think what color it is, right? We saw it in the stroop, but you still have to see the word. So. Right, so it's hard for if you manage to think of a way to construct a system in which you can give a name to something without actually seeing it first. That could be interesting.
Yeah, I'm just thinking of, I'm putting different thing of seeing something and then putting and then processing consciously the physical part of this symbol that I'm seeing.
Next week we're gonna talk about visual perception. So one of the things we're going to talk about are the slow tracks and the fast tracks, and that might maybe refer to what you're saying, of identifying something fast without seeing the details, and only then processing the details. Okay? But right now we're not there, but that's a good point. Yeah.
So what if the letter is displayed in an intact way, so some part of it is missing?
Yeah.
So if someone who is very familiar with the alphabet, he may say, okay, 90% or 80%, I'm sure it's capital A. But for some learner who hasn't been exposed to the alphabet, he may need more time or, to jump to
mm-hmm.
the conclusion or just make the wrong choice.
So that's a very good question. I'm not sure that Posner did this specific manipulation, but what would be the prediction? I know many others tried to do this. I'm not sure if Posner himself did. What would be a prediction from this model? Right, because you're asking about something which is out of context of trying to understand how the system is constructed and what the flow of information is. It's kind of anecdotal, right? So your question is, what if, let's say, two A's, but one is a bit blurry, for instance. Okay, so what would be the prediction?
I don't know.
But there would be a delay also.
There might be a delay, right? Because it's more difficult, the processing that happens within the physical level, so we will see an increased reaction time. Now the question is, which we will answer after the break, is if we see an increased reaction time, why don't we add another module? Because we added, right, that there's more processing, maybe there are more modules on the way. Okay, I think it's, no, we still have 2 minutes, and we started 2 minutes, in a delay of 2 minutes, so let's try to finish this first. Okay, so this explains the first effect, right, that if the physical features are the same, we have here some detour that we don't need to go through the semantic level, and we already can make a decision based on the physical features. But if the letters, the names are the same, but the physical features are different, we can't use this track, and we must go to the semantic level of representation, and it's slower. So this is the first finding. The second finding, just for sake of time, we'll do the second finding, we'll skip the third one, and we'll see how we are with the time. So the physical comparison, a mismatch, if the two letters, the answer is different, okay, for the two letters, is identified at the same speed for both A and AB, right? So if it's the same name, the different physical features. Now here, again, this arrow explains it perfectly. You don't have to go through the semantic level. Now imagine that what Mark, right? Okay, so that what Mark says, maybe it's don't know if you said exactly this, but maybe it's true. The semantic level comes first. This is semantic, this is physical.
What would be the prediction if we have the same semantics but different physical features?
It will take more time.
Right, we won't see that it's the same speed, right? It's just, wait. It's just like swapping number one and number two. Everyone sees that? Do you need to repeat it? I'll repeat it, just in case. So let's say we start with a semantic level, and this is the physical level, and the stimulus is same physical level, but different semantic level. So I'm now confusing myself. This is the semantic level, same in semantic level. So we can go directly over here. So we predict faster reaction times compared to when.
In this case, it will go to the physical because semantically it's the same, but physically it's different.
If
so
this was semantic
and
not physical,
go up and
like your suggestion, no. Then we can skip this part and go directly here because we don't need to analyze the physical features. We already analyzed it semantically, said the same, and even if the task is physical, we go directly here. So we predict that in the physical comparison, we will have a mismatch identified quicker for same thing. Okay, let's take a short break and we'll be back in 15 minutes. And I think we'll skip, we have many other things to talk about. I'll just conclude this part. This is just to show how to think about results when we try to build our system bottom up. Okay, we have factors. We think maybe each factor is processed in a different module. These are not the factors. Okay, the factors here are the different tasks. Okay, and we want to see how they interact, and their interactions are through the different arrows, how the information flows in the system. The different information flow tasks predict different reaction times under different tasks. So this whole thing was just to give an example. I don't think we'll talk about it after the break because it's not important enough to continue talking about it, but at home, if you want to see the two other predictions, you can play with it. Okay, so let's take a break and we'll be back in at 3 o'clock.
four different phone calls to get. It doesn't make that message across the megabytes, even though my messages are less than the megabyte. It's all been called by the IT department, but they couldn't get my IT department's phone number. Now they said fax it. I don't. Yeah, it's all, I already sent the email. Awesome. If you can't do it, that's fine. I'll figure out how to email it or fax it or something. But it's just, it's getting me.
Can I rephrase my question a little bit?
Yeah.
I think, can I draw it?
Sure.
What we say, for example, in the color experiment, we say that we process the first the word.
Mm-hmm.
First we read. Here is the input. There's another module here. That is the color. And there here we have the output. And here we ask the task, no?
I see, yeah.
And we have this, and we have this. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And the task here, for example, is to read color. Wait, read color.
Just like the plasma, just to say the same or different?
What?
Same or different?
Yes.
Okay.
Or for example, it's the same. It's, I think it's a different, the color and the color with the word. And you say, tell me the color. Right?
Okay.
So what we say here is that the input comes, and let's say it's this. That's the input,
okay.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
The input comes, first we read, then we decide the color, and then that's the output. That's why we have this delay, instead of when we have this. Here it's already the word, it's faster, it goes to the color, and then goes to the output.
Oh, we're talking about the strip effect, right?
Yes.
Okay. Because I thought we were...
It's basically very similar.
It's similar. Yeah, okay.
Or in this case, my question is, why not, why do we say that the input is just light coming into your eyes? Why the input has to go through this model first? Why cannot we have the input here and the input here? Input is the same thing that goes to both places. And then why we have a delay? Maybe because we're concentrated in the task you say. So tell me the color. I'm more concentrated in this than in this.
So you're saying instead, so this is the model that I showed of this group, that both information are extracted. Instead, do it like this, right? Start
uh-huh.
with the, okay, let's think of, first of all, it could be. So if we first see the word, let's say it's red colored and green, and the
no, wait. What we mean, in what we say is that the input goes only to one, first to one and then to the other.
Yeah.
Why doesn't it go to both at the same time?
According to this truth model, it does. Words, and you might be correct, but I'm not committing myself to any model. This is just a model that explains the data, and in order to know which model is correct, you need to make new predictions and then test them.
Okay.
So not everyone agrees that this is the model. It might explain it. I need to think about it for a few minutes. I mean, explaining it in the same like model that Posner showed, it might also explain it. The thing is that in the Stroop, it's
not just about shorter reaction times, it's really a strong interference.
You cannot say the word.
Yeah, like you, it's really saying, like people say red instead of green. It's not that they're delayed a little bit.
So the opposite of what
So, yeah, so that's why I think that the phenomenon is kind of different. Now, there could be ways of testing whether this is, yeah, that's why I said it's an automatic process. You can't not read the word. It's not like the same difference that you can't not say that.
That's another thing here. I misunderstood. How can color be controlled? You process color. You just think color.
No, the controlled process is to say that this is green, not to see the green. To name it. So the reason to think why the explanation is about automaticity is because we're very trained in reading. We're not, and if you train something many times, it becomes automatic, right? I mean, this is like, it sounds very intuitive. We're not trained in seeing colors and naming them. Like, we're not trained in saying gray, green, red. Like, we don't
right.
do that.
Right.
Not that much.
Okay.
So that's why this path becomes an automatic path, or a stronger path, if you want to use a connection.
Okay.
So
it really, you have an effect, and you can put any model that fits that effect.
Yeah, that's very problematic.
Yeah.
I mean, that's exactly the
yeah,
point
that's
that I wanted to...
Okay.
The right way to go, or the better way to go, is to first have a prediction, and a model of it to make a prediction, and then to test it. Because there are many
right.
different models that can fit one
right.
finding. And,
Right.
You want to verify
which way.
Which, yeah. So you need to build an experiment to test the model and not the other way around. That's the right way to do science. And that's the point that I want to get to
okay.
the end.
Thanks.
Continuing, where were we? Time to say.
Yeah. So Isai and Jonathan and okay, so we have two other findings which I think we're going to skip or just do really fast because it's basically just the same idea. We have a finding and we have a model that explains it, and we put the arrows between the boxes in a way that explains the reaction time pattern that we find. You know what, I will talk about this third feature because it is important for the next point. So in the physical comparison test, if we see B and C, which are different, we identify, we give the response faster than when the letters are O and Q, which is also different. So how is that explained? So first of all, this is the physical task. Naming is irrelevant, so this is not relevant, and we already have an arrow here. So what's going on here? I think you didn't ask me about it last time. I don't remember who said it.
this is more difficult because they look more similar. I remember who asked me, we see an increased reaction time because it's more difficult. And then the question is, how do we know not to add maybe a different module, right? Because more reaction time, let's say when we need to identify to perform a semantic test, then we have an error going here and here, and we predict an increased reaction time. But now we have an increased reaction time, and we're staying in the same module, and we didn't add anything. So how did we know? What other module could I add? Okay, let's skip this. Okay, so basically in cognitive science, reaction times are used a lot. We say many things of our cognitive system based on how fast we respond to different inputs. And usually the interpretation for a higher reaction time is, well, there are two options. Either we have another processing stage, like we have the semantic processing module after the physical processing module. If the task is semantic, we added a stage, so we measure higher reaction time. Another option is just that the input is more difficult, so there is more load on the same module. So these are two explanations for higher reaction times, and these two explanations help us to build the cognitive model of the flow of information between the different modules, between the input and the output. How do we know which of them is the right explanation for a higher reaction time? I measure now a higher reaction time. How do I know whether I need to add a stage in my model, or maybe it's just the same stage and the task is more difficult? So first of all, there is some common sense, right? I mean, maybe I can't give a rule for everything, but we'll now talk about a method for serial processing that is very, first of all, it's very intuitive, but it's also very used in interpreting results. So if we have a serial model, information starts in A, some sort of transformation, the output of A goes to B, B goes to C. The assumption is that the reaction time that I measure is the sum of the reaction time of each stage. So if I add a stage, let's say C, I add a reaction time which is unique to C. So this is an additive effect. If I add a factor, I add a stage, then I add a reaction time. And it doesn't matter if I remove B, then I remove the reaction time of B. If I remove B and C, I remove the summation, the sum of both B and C. So this is called the additive factor method. It's dated to Sternberg, but even before. The idea is to discover whether two factors that influence the task response, are they the same stage or two different stages? If they're additive, and just like we saw before, the interpretation is that these are two different stages. If they're interactive, then it's the same stage. What is additive and interactive? So let's see an example. So this is again a design table, okay? We have here factor A with two levels, and we have factor B with two levels. Let's ignore right now level two and factor B. So we see that factor A, level one and level two, okay, if we go from level one to level two, we add 50 milliseconds reaction time. Now, if we manipulate also factor B and add another level, so this level, again, going from level A to from level 1 to level 2 in factor A, we add again only 50 milliseconds of reaction time. So our interpretation here is that if something is, that the two factors, since the effects are additive, I manipulate. I manipulate level B. I do not affect whatever happens in factor B. Sorry, I do not affect what happens in factor A. So I can separate them into two different stages. So whatever happens in factor B, whether it's level 1 or level 2, manipulating factor A adds the same reaction time. So this is an additive effect. Okay, what would be an interactive effect? Anyone here took statistics? What? Different what? Okay, right. When I manipulate both, I move from level 1 to level 2 in factor B, and from level 1 to level 2 in factor A, I don't add just 50. It might be different. So this is called an interaction. So let's say 107. Okay, so I see that if I manipulate factor B, going from 1 to 2, it does matter in which level I am in factor A. I can't look at them separately. So if I'm asking you how much reaction time did I add if I moved to level 2 in factor B, you have to ask me, well, it depends, where are you in factor A? So it means that I can't separate and just look at what happens within factor B, so they're not the same stage. So an interactive effect, the interpretation is that something happens, that the two factors belong to the same stage. Was that clear? Interactive versus additive effects? Okay. So first of all, let's put the stages aside. An interaction means that if you manipulate one effect, right, you add reaction time. So let's say, I'll show an example later, but we'll see that in theory. So I add 30%, 30 milliseconds reaction time if I move from level 1 to level 2 in factor B. Let's say these 30 milliseconds are, let's say this is a memory test, okay, and this is the size of the memory set. So if I need to memorize 5 items compared to memorizing 3 items, then I see an increase in reaction time if I need to identify if an item belongs to the memory set or not, okay? So this is, let's say, the size of the memory set. When I increase the size of the memory set, I add from 3 to 5, I add 30 milliseconds reaction time. Okay, and I see it no matter what happens in, let's say, whether these are words in English or in Hebrew. This is the language, okay? So if it's in Hebrew, and Hebrew is my native language, I'm faster, and if it's in English, I'm slower, but no matter what, the size of the memory set, whether I add items, I add the same reaction time no matter what the language is. So we interpret it. So this is an additive effect. There is an effect of language. Okay, I add 50 milliseconds if I go from Hebrew to English. There is an effect of memory set. I add 30 milliseconds if I go from 3 items to 5 items, but there is no interaction. Okay, it's not that if there are more items and it's not my native language, something else happens. So if there is no interaction, this is an additive effect. And we say that the two factors in our design table belong to two different stages. So let's say first, identify the language, let's say stage 1, the linguistic processing, whatever, and then you memorize items after some sort of linguistic processing. So these two belong to two different stages. Now, if the effect is interactive, there is a dependency. You can't know how much you added if you increased your memory set without knowing in which language it was, for example. And then you say that interpretation would be, for instance, that memorizing words is part of the linguistic module. You cannot separate it. So your model in linguistic memory would be that there is the same stage for memory storage, which is language dependent.
You can try to say this table to a regression.
Right, exactly.
But I think that when we add interactive beta because of the data, so you need to add stage A, stage B, and the interactive.
Right. So, okay, I'll write down the regression model and just then tell me what she exactly means. I need, in order
how
to calculate the interaction, you must have
how
the main effect.
How do you translate this data to a regression when you have interaction?
Okay, so this is a question in statistics, right? Or is it not? I'm not. Okay. I have a reaction time, total reaction time. And this equals, or my regression model says that I have factor A and some sort of weight. Okay, so this is the beta of A, the weight of B, and the weight of the interaction. And some error term. So this is the regression model. If anyone here ever did ANOVA analysis of variance. It's, how many here took statistics? So you took and you took. Okay, so ANOVA is familiar. So it's basically ANOVA interaction or the interaction term in regression. So this is how statistically you calculate if you have an interaction or not. And this is not part of the course statistics. It's just the idea of what the interactive effect is. So this is how we decide whether we have two different stages or only one, which then the explanation of an increased reaction time if we have only one is saying, okay, it's more difficult. We added some processing load within the module. Now let's see an example. And I kind of like this example because this is my first publication from 2016. So the question is, are sentences with similar meanings processed the same way? What are sentences with similar meanings? So for instance, more than half of the circles are blue and less than half of the circles are yellow mean exactly the same thing if all I have is blue and yellow circles and they can be equal. Okay, let's say that this is the setting. So these two have equivalent truth conditions. So this is an example of more than half of the circles are blue and less than half of the circles are yellow. The two mean the same thing. Now, the question is, which will take longer to process? Will they take the same time to process or will they be the same? So, surprisingly, although they mean the same thing, it is more difficult, and when I say more difficult, I mean it's more reaction time. More time takes to respond to sentences with, this is called a negative quantifier. Okay, less is a negative quantifier, more is a positive quantifier. It doesn't really matter what quantifiers are, but I think it's very intuitive to conceive less as the negative of more. So we see that less than half takes longer than more than half, and a task that looks like this. The subject in front of a computer, they see at first a fixation cross, they have earphones. While they see the fixation cross, just so their eyes are fixated on the screen, they hear a sentence. For instance, less than, oh my god, than half of the circles are yellow. And then they see a picture, okay, after they finish the hearing the sentence. And they have to decide whether the sentence correctly describes the picture or not by pressing a button, one button for true, another button for false, and reaction times are measured. So for instance, if you hear, this was supposed to be an example, no audio, okay, less than half of the circles are yellow, and then you see this and you have to say yes. Okay, so this is the, basically it. Now, what is, another item, never mind, so assuming there was no linguistic inputs involved.
If we see two sets of circles and they have a certain ratio between them, so let's look at this example.
Okay, four circles and these are 16 circles. Will it be easier or difficult if I see this item, which are 8 circles and 16 circles? Now I'm not talking about the language, I'm talking about the numerosity perception, the visual perception. What will be more difficult?
This
one. Why?
They're closer together.
They're closer to each other, right? So the numerosity or the cardinality of the yellows is closer to the one of the blues. Closer in number?
No, they on the screen looks like if you want to separate them, the half of the screen is blue and the other half is yellow.
So it's not about this. In this specific experiment, we controlled for that. So the space they take on the screen is the same. That's why if we have fewer yellows, they're bigger than if we have this amount of number. We're talking only about numbers. Your comment is correct, and we controlled for that. But what Mark said, that this is more difficult because the number 8 is closer to the number 16 compared to the number 4 to 16. I want to remind you something we talked about last time. So the difference between 8 and 16 is 8. So according to what you said, the difference is 8 is more difficult compared to the difference of 12. So if it was 100 circles and 108 circles, this is
no,
the difference of 8, and 100 and 112.
No, because it's about a proportion.
It's about a proportion. And how do we call that? The ratio. Okay, so if you remember, someone in the very early days of psychology said something about perception going on a ratio scale. What?
Just noticeable
difference. Yeah, right. That has to do with the just noticeable difference as well. So from the just noticeable difference, which is a function, it's proportional to the baseline stimulus. So here we compare 16 to 8. From here we can derive an equation that says that perception goes on a logarithmic scale. So this is Weber-Fechner's law. So we talked about weights. I gave an example about weighing a package of sugar. So 1 kilo to half a kilo is the same like 4 to 2, 8 to 4, and so on. So Weber's law works in weights. It works in addition. It works only in low frequency, and it works in numerosity perception. So if you compare 4 to 8, it's like comparing 8 to 16. And this we know independently. Now, the question we want to ask, now back to the task. The task here is to compare two different sets of circles, and the ratio varies between different trials. Now, the question is whether there is some interaction between the linguistic processing and the visual processing of the numerosity. So one hypothesis is that there is a linguistic effect, which I already told you there is. Less than half takes longer than more than half. A second hypothesis is the linguistic effect is the result of the linguistic properties of the stimuli, which in other words, it means that less than half takes longer, not because we focus on something in the visual scene, but because the linguistic processing is more difficult. So hypothesis two basically says that linguistic processing and numerical processing are modular, so separate stages. Now the result, the way we did it, we'll skip to this. So the total reaction time we expect to see is, if it is modular, is reaction time that has to do with linguistic processing, reaction time that has to do with the numerical processing. Weber's law is here. Okay, the closer the ratio is to one, we expect to see a higher reaction time here, and then some other reaction times that have to do with other stuff. So this is the second hypothesis is correct. If they interact, then there should be also an interactive term. I'm skipping the results for a second, just to talk again about the design table. So we had a factor of polarity that could be positive or negative, and we had a factor of description that could be linguistic and non-linguistic, but I didn't mention it.
It's like the baseline, it's like the control.
Yeah, exactly. But the right way to look at the design table is to put here in the table the ratio. Now, notice it's exactly the same thing, just putting, we had four different ratios, or actually we had eight, this is a mistake. So right now I'm talking about the interaction between the polarity and the ratio. We had other factors as well. So this is a design of 8 by 2 by 2 by 2. Okay, this is how we call it. Now going back to the results, and then I'll talk about the non-linguistic condition. So these are the results. Okay, we have blue circles and yellow circles. The y-axis is the number of yellow circles. And this is on a logarithmic scale in accordance with Weber's law. So 8 to 16 should be similar, not exactly like 16 to 34. The number of blues are the same. Okay, so it's 16 blues, 8 yellows, 16 blues, 34 yellows. And we see that they're almost the same. I'm looking just at the red graph right now. So on a logarithmic scale, this is supposed to be symmetrical. Okay, everyone see that? We had another condition with a different number of blues, and again on a logarithmic scale it's symmetrical. Kind of in the back you can see a fit to a Gaussian function, which is symmetrical on a logarithmic scale. Now, the
y-axis is time?
The y-axis is reaction time.
Yes.
Yeah, we measure reaction time. Now what we see here, let's look only on the top graph. When the description, the instruction that the subject gets is less than half of the circles are blue, we see an increased reaction time compared to when the instruction is more than half of the circles are blue. So we see that the red graph is above the blue graph because for every single ratio, we have an addition of reaction time. However, when we extract the coefficient of these Gaussians, which is the baseline of the Gaussian, the amplitude, and the sigma, we see that the only difference between these two graphs is in the baseline. So the red graph is only a shift above the blue graph, which means that it doesn't matter what the ratio is between the blue and the yellow circles, we see that the addition and reaction time is the same. So this is our linguistic effect. The difference between the blue graph and the red graph is our linguistic effect of polarity, the less versus more. No interaction with the number or ratio between the circles. So this is a pure linguistic effect, which is, for us, it's very interesting because when we talk about language, there is some debate in whether language is modular or not, and this is a very strong hypothesis for modularity of language. Now, I just wanted to add the factor, the non-linguistic factor, just to say that we ran the same experiment with visual instructions. Subjects, instead of hearing a sentence, they saw a picture of red smaller than, yellow smaller than blue without using language, and we did not find any effect in the non-linguistic condition, which, again, supports the claim that it's not just about what we see and what the visual input is, but how we describe it, how we talk about it, what the linguistic material is. So this is an example of a more sophisticated example, because here we extract the coefficients after fitting Gaussian functions. But still a nice example of modular processing, a modular conclusion of how our processing system is constructed. Any questions about that? Okay. So I'll conclude with talking a little bit about research methods in cognitive science or in studying behavior in general. So there are some problematic methods, right? So far I've talked about experiments, but there are other methods. One of them is introspection. What is introspection? Anyone remember? We talked about it last time. I mean, I know it was a long time ago, but we did mention introspection related to some German guy. Doesn't ring any bell? So, Wilhelm Wundt, the father of psychology, the first laboratory in psychology that conducted experiments, he believed in introspection. So his subjects would, for instance, look at pendulums, and he would ask them for their sensation, for their report on what they see, how they sense it. Because he believed that the only way to approach our mind is by introspecting within ourselves or asking other people to introspect. He did not use reaction times, which is, of course, a more objective measure. So why is introspection a problematic method?
Subjective.
It's completely subjective, right. So it's prone to errors, for instance, memory, for instance, maybe subjects will not, don't want to tell the whole truth of what they sense. There is no way to quantify it. It's very difficult to build models based on introspection. You might affect the subject, right? Exactly. And there's a whole course on talking about how to properly run an experiment without the experimenter affecting subject's behavior. So this is problematic method number one, as I said. Another problematic method that is very widely used is a naturalistic observation. So what would that be, for instance? So I can say that baby's behavior during different developmental stages, I can observe that and then come to different conclusions. What is problematic about this?
Researcher can see different things.
Okay, but if you measure, let's say, objective measures, let's take gender, for instance, because this is also something that people really like to argue about. I have an observation that there are fewer females who are in politics. This is an observation. And I can go country by country, and same observation country by country. What's
so
problematic about this?
There's a lot of factors involved.
There's no causal effect.
Okay, there's no causal effect. I mean, the observation, there's no problem with the observation. The question is, what is the conclusion?
I mean, it's not only because of behavior, because you would think, oh, girls like less politics, but maybe it's because they can't, or because there's politics in their country that don't let
yeah.
them. There's
so
no factors.
Yeah, there's no, you don't know the cause, as Macheva said. And as you said, there are many different causes for explaining the underrepresentation of women in politics or in science or in you name it. There are just so many. And there is no problem with having observations, but the problem is that in many different cases we can't manipulate, right? We can't run a controlled experiment. We can't now create a new universe in which women are, I don't know, raised differently and then see what happens. So if we want to come to conclusions about causes and effects, so just observations are problematic. Correlation studies, which are almost very similar to just observations. Okay, so the gender example maybe is more of an example of a correlation study, But a better example of a correlation study is just for the Hebrew speakers here, just open the science section in the Ynet, and anything reported there almost is a correlation study, and badly reported with made up sources. But what is a correlation study? For instance, it was found that people who drink 5 cups of coffee a day live longer. So then the title is, you should drink more coffee.
And in correlation, there is an expectation.
In a correlation, you can have, well, not necessarily, but yeah, that's why I said the gender maybe fits more the correlation. Here, there's no correlation. You just observe something that happens in time. Another observational science is, for instance, astrophysics, right? You can't really run an experiment on planets, but you observe planets. You observe, right? So there is no real correlation here, but they really do have to do with each other because the gender example is observational and correlational. The coffee example is, so what's the problem with correlation studies? The coffee example, drink more coffee, live longer.
There's still not correlation.
Okay, right. Because, and this is again like statistics A.
Yeah, N is too low.
What?
The N is too low.
Not necessarily. You can have a, I mean, you can do a, you can do a correlation on everybody in the world.
Right.
It doesn't, you're still, there's still no correlation.
Maybe. You don't know.
Because you did. The correlation alone does not indicate.
Okay,
the
so we can have drink more coffee. So this is coffee, and this is longer life. This is causation in one direction, right? And this is the wine is the title of causation, but it can be in the other direction. People with the genes of living longer life also have, I don't know, a genetic tendency to drink more coffee. I don't know, something like that. And they could both be an outcome of a third factor, which is in most cases, this is the case in correlational studies, which are very badly done, that you see, you find a correlation between two different things just because there's a third factor that causes both of them. And in the case of coffee and life, that could be, for instance, I know, income. If you have more money, you buy more coffee. If you have more money, you have more access to, I know, getting health and stuff like that. I know, just so many. I just came up with something. You can come up with just so many. So what's the right way to run experiments? Which is basically what we saw so far. Controlled experiments. You run it in the lab, you have a design table. If you have a design table, you have a controlled experiment because each and every cell is filled with items. So you can control the level in each factor and have a baseline to compare to. All the examples we saw are of controlled experiments. And we saw reaction time, mainly as a behavioral measurement. But in cognitive science, there are other measurements that are used. Other than reaction time, we can use error rates. Okay, if the task is the same or different, I didn't have to measure reaction time. I could also have measured the accuracy level or the performance, whether the subject was right or wrong. There is a known speed accuracy trade-off that usually when subjects answer easy items or answer it faster and have lower error rates. Okay, but if you answer if it takes you more time to answer something, it's more likely that you will be accurate. So this is the trade-off: longer reaction time, higher accuracy. Other measurements, we can use questionnaires, we can analyze error types and so on, and this is behavioral. And we can also try to look in the brain and use neurological measurements to study behavior. So ERP is one example. EEG, everyone knows what that is?
Yes.
So you put electrodes under a skull and you measure the electrical waves based on a specific test. So for instance, you hear in our test, you hear a sentence, see a picture. I could not necessarily measure reaction time. I could have measured your electrical change in the brain. If they take many EEGs and average, then that's called an ERP, evoked-related response. We'll maybe talk about it later in the course. So these are examples of different ERPs. So let's say the opposite of the sentence is here. I can measure. These are just different ERP examples on one graph. And I can talk about differences between the different electrical responses. I can measure activation in the brain and say something about localization. In ERP or EEG, I only say something very broadly about where the activation is from. Using PET or fMRI, I can say my time resolution is lower, but state resolution is higher. I can say where the activation is from. Everyone knows fMRI? Yeah, is someone here not familiar with what functional MRI is? I mean, not technicalities, but with me seeing nice pictures of the brain. So PET is like fMRI. It has a better resolution, but it requires a radioactive I thought you said time. Okay, so this is an example of an fMRI. We can say something about activation levels in the brain. Let's say red is higher, green is lower. I think we'll skip this. So we said time, and I see that we have 3 minutes. You can look at it at home. There is a nice model to explain the trade-off between reaction time and accuracy, which is the diffusion model, but it's not important enough. So throughout the course, we will talk mostly about reaction time, a little bit about functional MRI. Maybe we'll talk about EEG and ERPs as well. But these are all, you can say these are measures of behavior, okay? Functional MRI, people say that you study the brain sick, which is true, but most cognitive scientists use fMRI or EEG just as another measure to find differences in behavior. To say that something is more difficult, then you have a higher activation in fMRI or higher electrical response, and that's what's important. It's just like reaction time in this respect. So it's important to note that. So when we build an experiment, it's important to know what our research question is and how the experiment provides the answer. So we saw, I think we saw three experiments, right, throughout this introduction, the Strook, the Posner, and our experiment. So each experiment was aimed to answer a specific question. And based on the results, we built a model to explain something about how our cognitive system is constructed and what the flow of information is, which basically is our goal in cognitive science. But I wanted to add that after we have a model, we need to think what predictions this model supplies, and then we need to test them. Because the Stroop effect, I gave you a model, let's stick to the boxes and arrows model. There was no objection here. There could have been other models as well. And the important thing about psychology to remember is that psychology is not, or cognitive science, it's not a descriptive science, at least the good part of it. It's supposed to be a predictive science. So you can't just come up with a model based on an experiment without having predictions from these models and then further testing them. So the best way to do science, any science, and in particular cognitive science, is have a theory and then go and test it. So have your model or ideas of different models before running the experiment, and then the experiment will adjudicate between the two different models. So this was just the introduction. So starting from next week, we'll start to talk about cognitive science itself and I'll have to kind of zoom out to understand what are the methods in cognitive science and the history and different models and basic terminology. Don't forget the reading task. Find a variation of the Stroop effect and what the generalization is from this variation by next week. Are there any questions? Okay. So next week we'll talk about visual perception.
Bye.
Bye.